The Rime of the Ancient Mariner. Rime of the Ancient Mariner. Earlier what we have studied is two poems we have studied, and those two are what we can say are sonnets. One is Shakespeare's sonnet, the other is a regular sonnet. And the sonnet, they have two parts in it. One is 8 lines one, the other is 6 lines one. Octet and sextet. That is the structure of sonnet. You have seen them, both of them, Shakespearean one and Ozymandias. These two are sonnets. This is a ballad. Before I tell what is a ballad, I shall say what is a sonnet. Then you will be knowing, understanding the difference between these two. Sonnet, it is having only 14 lines. First 8 introduce and last 6, they bring about the solution. Likewise, octet and sextet, 14. And here it is a ballad. Ballad is what? It is a poem. Used, very simple words are used to bring about a great meaning. Also, it talks about some ancient happenings, very ancient, or biblical stories they contain, or they have a moral, a story and a moral, or we can see the God's presence in the poem. That is ballad. Earlier to that, we have studied the Nightingale and the Frog. That is again a lyrical poem, it is. Means to sing and to read, to recite, it is a very easy one, and we get a kind of pleasure in doing that. Lyrical, sonnet, and now we are going to see what is a ballad. It is a very long poem, very long, written by our S.T. Coleridge, Samuel Taylor Coleridge. So you can see when you read the poem, his language, his style, and his descripting methods, that we can read through this poem. What is this poem anyway? It is a poem of a sailor. The sailor repents on certain wrongdoing. The sailor repents upon a wrongdoing. Men are there. To err is human. We read it, we know it, and we practice it also. And we do something wrong and we say very simply, to err is human. If I don't do that mistake, I would not have been a man. That way we just escape. But whatever you do here, you are to get the results here itself. Nothing will be accounted for in your account. Nothing is pending. Such kind of philosophy the poem teaches us. Marriages are there. Human being, even our Shakespeare said, the human being character can be split into 7 stages. Right? In the drama As You Like It, we have the speech, a great speech of Jacques, 7 ages of the man. We have it. Here, one of the stages is marrying stage. People were rushing towards the marriage, to attend the marriage. 3 people were going. And one of them was caught. And he was being told this story. Hear the story. What kind of a story? Does it have any merriment in it? No, a very long and what we can say, very boring story. It is being told to a person who was supposed to go to attend a marriage party. Why this again? People are there. They repent on their things, what they have done. They feel, if I tell whatever I have done, the wrong which I have done, if I tell it, at least a kind of what burden is reducing from my mind. So the ancient mariner, once upon a time he was a mariner, and now he is not a mariner, and he sits on an overturned boat. And he calls everybody, whosoever goes from there, And he calls him and he tells about this incident which occurred in his life, so that he may be losing some kind of burden from his mind. So what does he say? And what are his experiences? What he wants to say? How this marriage guest feels over there? Let us see all the feelings through the poem. That is the poem here. So, what can you see in the picture? First one, does the man look happy? Give reason for your answer. There is a picture here and there is a net and a man having a bird hung in his neck. This again, one kind of what we can say, a culture, a custom, which is still there in our Hinduism. Suppose a milkman is there. A milkman, he tames cows also and he keeps buffaloes even. By chance or by bad luck, one of the cows died under his care because of his carelessness. So the noose which is tied to the cow and to the peg, the rope, that rope the person, the milkman, should have in his neck. And he should not talk to anybody. He should not cook, he should not earn. And whatever he gets on begging, only on that he has to live for certain days. And by that, it is said, it is believed that his sins which occurred due to the death of that cow will be vanished away. Why I told this is, this kind of a culture, a custom, you may call it as a superstition whatsoever, it is still there prevailing in our Hinduism. Means one should knowingly not become the reason for the death of a cow, because cow is the very pious animal for us, right? So now this albatross, the bird is albatross which he is having in his this one, this is being regarded as the good luck and good woman. What is good woman? If at all it comes, if I see it when I am going out, that day it goes very good. The day, the whole thing will be very good and I will be gaining something, profitable day. That one is a good woman. And likewise, the albatross is also a good woman. But the navigator, the mariner, what did he do is, he killed that albatross. And that burden he was having. This is a symbolism for having that burden on his head or through his neck. Did he hang it? No, the burden is still there on him. That is symbolism, symbolically expression of what, under what burden that navigator was, ancient mariner was. So whosoever goes on the road, he calls and he tells and he feels that he is relieved of this pain to some extent. Whomsoever, he repeats, goes on repeating the same thing to everybody. And this Coleridge was attracted by. What is this? What is this old man doing? Why he is telling everybody? By that he got some kind of influence. Yes, impressed by the old man's doing. And so he has written it in his verses. So let us read. And here, first question we have answered. It is a thing. And reason also we have answered. And next one is, why does he have the bird hanging around his neck? Either it is a symbolism, or if at all the man has that bird, to feel the burden of his sin who has committed, which has been committed by him. Now, see, the Rime of the Ancient Mariner is one of the best known classical poems written in English, containing some very beautiful and memorable lines. You may find that it needs some work and attention from you to understand it. Yeah, we are to understand it, and so attention is very much needed. And now, Before you are in a position to appreciate and respond to the beauty of the language that it contains. The Rime of Ancient Mariner is a ballad. I already told you that it tells a story. Ballad poetry usually includes archaic words, very old words and spellings. Right? Now let us see the poem, what it contained, how it has been told. And it is a very lengthy one. Let me read it once for you and then a simple explanation will be there. So, since it is a long poem, only the first two parts have been included here. It is a very long one, has 7 parts. Right? Only 2 have been included here for our reading. Your teacher will help you read the other 5 parts after the complete of this unit. Okay? Now, part 1. It is an ancient mariner and he stopped one of the 3 by the long grey beard and glittering eye. Now, wherefore stoppest thou me? Now, there were 3 people going. What for were they going? They were going to attend a marriage. They were the marriage guests. One of the 3 was stopped. Remaining went away. Why? They were not influenced by the look of the man, by the beard and by the eyes of the man. They were not at all influenced. So they both have gone and he remained there. And after getting, waiting over there, stopped over there, he asked, why did you stop me? See the thing. He stopped himself because the old man, something attracted from the old man, he stopped over there. He questions the old man, why did you stop me? Wherefore stoppest thou me? Thou is you. Why did you stop me? Why have you stopped me? That way he questioned. There bridegroom's doors are opened wide, and I am next of kin. The guests are met, the feast is ready, is set. Mayst hear the merry din. Mayst hear the merry din. You see, as it is said, it has contained many archaic words and spellings beautifully arranged to bring about the rhyme even. Right? So here what is the thing? The bridegroom's door are opened wide. They are inviting me, inviting everybody. I am the guest. I am not from a very distant relative. No, I am very close kin. Very nearly related to the bride. Okay? And so I am to go. Bridegroom's doors are open and I am very near to him. A very near relation. And so I'll have to go. And the guests are met. The feast is set. Guests are coming. They are entering in. And the feast is also ready. So at any cost I'll have to go there. Okay? Mayst hear the merry din. Don't you hear the merry din? Din means a kind of what we can say, alarum. Means many people talking at a time, shouting at a time. That is called as you are din, D-I-N, din. But it is not horrifying din and it is not the fearful din, but it is a merry din because occasion is a merry occasion. So, mayst hear, don't you hear? May I, don't hear? Or don't you hear? You see, here. There is a sound, very pretty and very happy sound is coming. Shoutings are going on there. I'll have to go there. He holds him with his skinny hand. The hand is skinny, means only skin and bones are there. There is no muscle at all. With that he caught who? The ancient mariner. Whom? The guest. The guest was caught by the skinny hand of the ancient mariner. There was a ship, cut he did not say why he stopped. Simply he said, cut, Q-U-O-T-H, cut means said. Quote word is there, quoting. Mahatma Gandhi quotes and Rabindranath Tagore quotes, Vivekananda quotes, we write in the school, right? That quote word has come from cut. So, he cut, he said. What did he say? There was an old ship. See here. There was an old ship. Is that necessary here to be told? But he started like that. Hold off, unhand me, graybeard loon. As soon as his hand dropped, he. Now, what nonsense you are talking? I asked you why you are stopping me here. I am to attend the marriage and you hold my hand. How dare you are? Leave me, leave my hand. What is the wording here for the leave my hand? You see here, hold off. Hold off, hold on. Hold on means catch. Hold off means leave. Hold off, unhand me. Hand means catch, unhand means leave. Unhand me, leave me alone. Grey beard loon, how he addressed him. Grey, we know. Beard, we know. Grey beard means the beard is completely become grey. Loon, loon means nothing but a mad fellow, lunatic fellow. You lunatic fellow, you mad fellow, why did you catch me? You stopped me, I am asking, why did you stop? And you caught me also, leave my hand. That way, the marriage guest has become a bit angry. So, as soon as his hand dropped, means immediately. Immediately is as soon as. Right? He leaves it quickly. Dropped his hand, leaves his hand. He holds him with his glittering eye. There is no physical holding. But there is some holding, and hence the guests stood there without any movement. Not only standing, he sat on a rock over there. You see the power of eyes. What did he see? What did the guest see? We don't know. What did this fellow, mariner, show in his eyes? That too we do not know. Only thing is, he left the hand but held the guest by his eyes, right? He holds him with his glittering eye. The wedding guest stood still and listens like a 3 years child. You see, he was wild earlier. Leave my hand, he was wild. Now he was listening to the mariner in a child, as if he's a child, he is hearing. Where wild, where child? There he did not put the word wild, but to bring about the meaning of earlier thing, he put this child here, and let us understand that the person became wild earlier. Now he himself presents as a child here. See the beauty. So, the mariner hath his will. Now, because he could able to catch him through his eye, glistening eyes, glittering eyes, the mariner has the upper hand to talk to him. Yes, I can talk to him, and whatever I say, he will hear, he will sit here. The eyes, so to say, are mesmerizing. Right? The eyes are such, has the power to mesmerize somebody. He forgets everything and he sits there. So, the wedding guest sat on a stone, he cannot choose but hear, and thus spake on the ancient man, the bright-eyed mariner. The bright-eyed mariner thus spake on. Spake means nothing but spoke. Earlier past tense to speak is spake. Now it is replaced by spoke. So, the mariner, ancient mariner started speaking, and the guest has no choice excepting sit on a stone and hear whatever he says. See the power of the eyes. And so lastly he said again, the bright-eyed mariner. The ship was cheered, the harbour cleared, merrily did we drop, below the kirk, below the hill, below the lighthouse top. And now we set sail, we are going, merrily we entered into the sea, everything was happy. We went into the sea. And what are the steps to say? Merrily, the ship was cheered. Means, sayonara, see you, bye bye, go. This, everybody cheered up for us, for our safe journey. And so the ship left the harbor. Right? And the harbor cleared. It cleared the harbor. Everybody waved at us. We are clear. the harbour. We went into the sea. Merrily did we drop below the kirk. We were dropped below the kirk. That is, the church is there above. The hill is there. On that, the church is there. And we have crossed that. Means our ship was appearing as if it is a small toy. Because it is on the mountain. And there is a church over there. Below that, we were passing as if we are very small miniatures in the ship. Because the church is high, very high. It has that kind of respect over there. Under that, we were going. And next, the lighthouse was also there. Under that also, we have sailed. Right? That way, he put everything, whichever is available, on the seashore when the ship was leaving. The sun came up upon the left. The sun came up upon the left. Means, is it left? Or the sun rises from the left? No. It rises from the east. And if the sun is rising from here, means what? We are traveling to the right. When we are traveling to the right, then the sun, because it is the east here, the sun comes from here. Right? So, the direction is rightward direction. They are going towards right. The sun came up upon the left. Out of the sea came he, and he shone bright, and on the right went down into the sea. And he shone bright, all day long it was shining, and he sank into the right, that means into the west. We are going towards the one direction, that is the southward direction we were going. Higher and higher every day we are going higher and higher, till over the mast at noon. The sun every day comes, every day sinks, right? He goes every day higher and higher till it comes onto the mast. What is a mast? There is a big pole and to that the sails are tied. That is called mast, right? And there the sun appears higher and higher every day till over the mast at noon. The wedding guest here beat his breast for he heard the loud bassoon. See here. So by the noon, the sun comes to the head. That way, the ancient mariner is talking about his incident, his story. Now what happened? There is a sound, blaring sound from the bassoon. What is this bassoon? It is a musical instrument in the band party. The band one, band baja, in that there is a very big brass pipe you can see with a this big opening. That is bassoon. Right? It blared over there. Then the chief guest, the marriage guest, he could not but hold his head and thump his chest. Why? He was not allowed to go. And this fellow is talking. Unnecessary things. What is that to me? If his ship is cheered, if it went inside the sea, ocean, if the sun comes from the left, why I should bother about it? Is it not? That way he is bet his breast, for he heard the loud bassoon. The bride hath paced into the hall, red as a rose is she, nodding their heads before her goes the merry minstrelsy. Now, the bride has entered into the hall. Hall of that marriage, the doors are open and the bride is walking. So, the beautiful bride, and she was walking ahead into the hall. Ahead of her, there are these minstrelsy. Minstrelsy means musicians who were there, they were singing. They were playing instruments, they were doing everything, they were going ahead and she was following. How was she? We can see here. Red as a rose is she. From top to bottom, she was dressed as a red rose. She was walking. And nodding their heads, before her goes the merry minstrels. They were playing like this and nodding their heads, and they are going before the bride. They are going. The wedding guest, he beat his breast, yet he cannot choose but hear. He bet his chest. Bichara, the wedding guest here, sitting on the stone, only he could do this, but there is no option with him that he cannot leave, he cannot go, and cannot ask him, stop your story, I don't want to hear you. He cannot. Why? Some magic power has tied him there to hear the ancient madness story. Right? So, and now the storm blast came, and he was tyrannous and strong. He struck with his overtaking wings and chased us south along. Now the sun was there. Now suddenly the atmosphere, the climate got changed. Storm has come. Winds have blown very tremendous, very furious, very tyrannous. Winds were blowing. And these tyrannous winds, these strong winds, they were blowing our ship towards the north, further and further. We were sailing towards north, towards south. But the winds were also pushing us towards the south. We were pushed. With sloping masts and dipping prow, as who pursued with yell and blow, still treads the shores of his foe, and forward bends his head, the ship drove fast, loud roared and blast, and southward, we fled. Now how it is going, and how tyrannous, or how, what we can say, troublesome, how strong, right, how furious the winds were. To describe that, he said, with sloping masts. Masts are there, but are they straight? No, they are sloping. Why? The wind is pushing. As great the wind is, the masts are that sloped, they have become bent, just like your bow, they have become. They are to take the pressure, because the sails are there to the mast. The sails are pushed with a strong wind, and so the mast has got a curved thing, just like a slope. They are bent. And prowl is there. Prowl means the front part of the ship. And that is sinking down. Because from there, behind the wind is there, it is pushing, and the front part is going down. Now, dipping prow, as who pursued with yell and blow. Now, because that is being pursued with the yell and blows. This means the wind is blowing in such a manner as if somebody is pushing, yelling, go, 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 go. As if there somebody is telling like that, it has to go, it has to hurry up. That is what the masts are bent and the prowl is dipped. Right? So that way it is going. Still trades the shadow of his foe, as if there is some enemy behind. The shadow of the enemy behind, we are to hurry. It is not in our hands. The wind is pushing, and so the ship is going ahead, as if some enemy is pursuing them. Likewise, the ship is going. Which is that enemy? That means non-seeing, non-visible. We could not see, it is not visible. That kind of enemy is following, as if it is pursuing. Our ship is drifting ahead. Forward bends his head, the ship drove fast, loud roared the blast. The waves are touching and they are blasting and they are roaring, and the ship is being pushed towards the south. And southward, we fled. We are not sailing. I hope our ship is flying. It is like that. The speed of the ship is such. We feel sometimes it is going down, sometimes it is going up. And hence I feel as if I am on the flight of the ship. And now there came both mist and snow, and it grew wondrous cold, and ice mast high came floating by as green as emerald. Now, so far there was the storm was there, wind was there. We were pushed towards the south. What does the South Pole has? Nothing but ice, right? So we have reached to that place, to that point where, and now there came both mist and snow. Mist and snow. Earlier I have talked about this. What is a mist and what is a snow? Snow is nothing but the fog, which has just turned into water and it got frosted there. That is snow, right? And only water is there in the cloud and our clothes are getting wet, that is mist. So there came mist and snow. Which is that, which is what? The sailor could not make out, the mariner could not make out. But both have come at a time. And it grew wondrous cold. Earlier sun was there, very bright sun. We were feeling scorchy. Because it is there here, ahead. Now because the frost is there, the mist is there, the snow is there, then we started feeling cold. The cold wind started blowing. And now there came the both mist and snow, and it grew wondrous cold, and ice, mast high, came floating by. And ice is coming from ahead. How high it was? It was about the mast. That big ice, how it appeared? It appeared green as if it is made of emerald. It appeared pretty green, right? A ice mast high came floating by as green as emerald. It appeared as if some emerald stone is floating in the water and it is coming towards us. You see how dangerous was it, right? And now, and through the drifts and snowy cliffs did send a dismal sheen, nor shapes of men nor beasts of kin, the ice was all between. See how the ice played, what it does. Here we cannot see through this. Where is the man, where is the beast? Where is the animal, where is the man, where is the bird, where is what? Where is what? We could not make out. Because everywhere there came a sheet of ice or mist or your fog. It is there. So we could not make out what is what. That was the thing. But still our ship is drifting, going ahead and going ahead. And where it is? It is going towards the snowy cliff. Cliff means the, what we can say, it is a wall-like structure made of ice. It is going towards it. Means if it dashes, kalas, everything is gone. Nor shapes of men nor beasts we can. K and can is see. We could see nothing before us. Though a person is here, I could not see. Because a thick sheet of frost has covered both of us. Neither he could see me, nor I could see him. That was the condition. The ice was all between. Everywhere, between two people, between two things, between two eyes even, there is ice. That is the situation there. The ice was here. The ice was there. The ice was all around. You see, the same thing. But how it has been described? The ice is here. The ice is there. The ice is all around. Right? It crackled and growled and roared and howled. See the words. It cracked, it growled, it roared, and it howled. Tuck, 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 tuck. It is going upward, each and every word. Means the gravity of the presence of the ice has been described with these four words. And they are put in an orderly manner. It is onomatopoeia. Earlier, as has been used, that is your simile. Means the whole poem is studied with all figure of speeches here. So Like noises in a sound. There were the voices. What kind of noises we have? Like they are coming out from a fainting person. A fainting person is there. Right? He is getting fainting. What he talked, nobody knows. But voice comes. That kind of voice is making out. That means this sounding, this crackling, this growling, this roaring has no meaning. It is only sounds. Sounds like a person, one who is getting fainted, who he speaks. If at all he speaks something, he speaks like that. Now, at length did cross an albatross. Through the fog it came, as it had been a Christian soul. We hailed it in God's name. Hailed, we called. In the God's name. Why? There was no creature at all nearby. But from somewhere the bird has come. So we have become very happy. You must have read the story of Friday. Right? Robinson Crusoe. Friday, he was not able to speak anything. He doesn't know any language. But here, Robinson Crusoe became happy because the other person is there. Now, these people are in a state of, what we can say, panicky. What will happen with us? They do not know. But a bird could able to come. Means what? Now, the storm is going to stop. And there would be some clear weather. As if the bird has brought this message, as if the message has been sent through God, we hail him by the name of God. So, it ate the food it never had eat, and round it flew. The ice did split with a thunder fit. The helmsman steered us through. Now, the bird eats food here in the ship. And it ate the food as if it did not eat any food for years. Means a quite good amount of food it was eating. And it stirred all round the ship as if it is clearing the ice. Now there is a clearance of ice. Because the man at the steering, he could able to find out a way to steer the ship. So here you see, ice did split with a thunder fit, the helmsman here is the person who steers the ship. He could able to find a place to steer the ship. And a good south wind sprung up behind, the albatross did follow, and every day for food or play came to the mariner's hollow. It used to go ahead, we used to go behind it. Right? Sometimes it used to come back to the ship. What for? For the food. Right? That way it used to come and visit. And when it has the food, it used to go. Right? Whenever the persons in the ship, whenever they called it, it used to come for the food. That has become a routine between the ship, people in the ship, and albatross. It means everything is going smooth. Earlier it was very disastrous. They were not knowing where they hit and where they may be scattered all around on the ice. They may die. But because of the albatross, they could able to get a hope of going away from the place to a safety. And the bird was flying ahead of the ship. Whenever people call it, come on, have your food, the albatross used to come and have its food. Right? Up to then, it was going everything smoothly. Then occurs something. What is it one? In mist or cloud, unmasked or shroud, it perched for vespers nine, whilst all the night, through fog smoke white, glimmered the white moon shine. Now, what more the bird used to do? Wherever it gets a space, there it perches and it sleeps there. So what are the words put over here? You see, in mist or cloud, It never bothered whether it is a cloudy one or a mist one whatsoever. It doesn't bother. On mast or shroud, whether it is a mast I am perching here, or whether it is a sail, shroud is a sail. Shroud means what? A piece of cloth. Sail is a bigger piece of cloth. Right? And on that, or on the mast, or here in the mist, or in the cold, in the cloud, wheresoever, it used to perch. Perch means sit. For Vespers 9 means exactly as if it is a disciplined bird, exactly on the same time every day. If it comes and if it perches, we can see the time. Yes, 9 o'clock in the night. That way we can make out the time. We can make out the Vesper time, Vesper 9, it is connected with the churches. Because at that moment, every Christian, they gather there. And there will be a mass prayer that is called Vesper 9. So at that Vesper 9, it perches. Whilst all the night, through fog smoke white, glimmer the white moonshine. So whether the moonshine is glimmering, brightly going on, or twinkling, or sparkling, or what we can say is shining, whatsoever, it never bothered. It used to perch over there. And all night it used to be there in that place. It has become a routine for it. God save thee, ancient mariner, from the friends that plague thee thus. Why look'st thou so? With my crossbow I shot thee, albatross. God save thee, ancient mariner, from the friends that plague thee thus. Aray, what is this? People, why they are treating you like this? Ill treatment, why they are giving? Why they are insulting? The plague word is called insulting. Why they are insulting? Why they are misbehaving with or ill treating you? God save thee, because the bird you have taken care and you are looking after it. By mistake, the wedding guest said this. Then immediately the mariner says, why looks thou so? Why are you looking like that? Why are you sad about it? Right? Then he says, with my crossbow, I shot the albatross. Why I look this? Why people are blaming me? Why they are insulting me? Right? Because of my own action, I am ashamed. What did I do? I have killed the very bird myself with my own bow and arrow. There ends the first part. And second part starts with one again, the sun. The sun now rose up the right. Earlier it had come on the left. Now it comes on the right. Means what? They are coming back. Sun is very particular. It comes from the east, sinks in the west. Right? But now, for the convenience of the poem, to say into what direction they sailed and again how they are coming back, he has used the sun as if it is coming from the left and coming from the right. So now they are on the backward journey. The sun now rose upon the right, out of the sea came he, still hid the in mist, and on the left went down into the sea. There is a mist. His rays are not that harmful. He is coming from the right and going into the left. And the good south wind still blew behind. Now, south wind, from there it is pushing. Earlier, towards the south it was pushing, the wind. Now, south wind is pushing my ship. But no sweet bird did follow. There is no bird to follow because I killed it. I have done a very, what we can say, heinous job. I killed with my own bow. There is no bird to follow. We are going. But no sweet bird did follow, nor any day for food or play came to the mariner's hollow. Mariners were calling, oh ho, oh ho, but no ho, nothing. The bird is not coming. Why? There is no bird. What happened to the bird? I killed it with my own bow and arrow. And I had done a hellish thing, and it would work them woe. I have done a hellish thing, a sin I have done, committed, and further the people are suffering. Right? They are to have the woes. Woe means suffering. For all averred, I had killed the bird, and they said firmly that I have killed the bird that made the breeze to blow. A wretch, said they, the bird to slay that made the breeze to blow. Don't you think properly? Why did you kill it? Because of the bird, the wind is blowing. It has blown because of that. We were saved. We were going towards again, back home, because of the bird. How could you kill it? How hellish thing you have done? That way, every person was blaming me. Nor dim, nor red, like God's own head, the glorious sun upraised. Upraised is upraised. And how was it? Nor dim, nor red. It is not completely dim, just like a silver plate. Nowadays you can go to Delhi and you can have the silver plate look of the sun. Not even that, not dim. Not even a red bright, no. It was just like that, like God's own head. If you see Jesus Christ, if you see Rama, Krishna and Bhagavan Buddha, all these things, there will be an aroma around the head. Right? That is represented here as a head, God's head. The glorious sun upraised. The glorious sun, which is glowing and which has a very good light, it is glowing over there. Then all averred, I had killed the bird. Everybody said, you have killed the bird, you have done a sin, you have committed a sin. That way everybody is telling, averred, to say something confirmed manner. So, that brought the fog and mist. It was right, said they, such birds to slay, that bring the fog and mist. Now, because you killed it, earlier because the bird was there, there was wind, it was very pleasant. Now, because the bird is not there, the mist is there, the fog is there, where we are going, we do not know, there is no direction, there is no people going ahead, there is no bird going ahead to show us the direction. So you have done a very wrong thing you have done. You have done a mistake, you have committed a sin. That way people were blaming me. The fair breeze blew, the white foam flew, the furrow followed free. We were the first that ever burst into that silent sea. Now, the fair breeze blew. The breeze was very fair. Wind and breeze. Wind is a strong one. Breeze is not strong one. It is a very light one, lighter one. It is blowing pleasantly. We are having that pleasantness. The white foam flew. Foam was there on the surface. It is flying along with the breeze. The furrow followed free. When we were going in the sea, no, there was ice over there. When we are moving forward, we can see backside as if it is a mowed down land. It was appearing, the water was appearing like that. And we were going ahead. Furrow we can see there behind. Followed free, we were the first that ever burst into the silent sea. Because it is a very clear one. We can go. And so we have burst with the shout of happiness, and we were the one amidst the sea. Down dropped the breeze, the sails dropped down. It was sad as sad could be, and we did speak only to break the silence of the sea. Down dropped the wind. If the wind is not there, what will the mast and the sails do? So we have to pull them down. We have pulled them also down. And that phenomenon, how it has been put over there, let us see just, what is that one? The fair breeze blew, the white foam flew. First, in the second stanza, down dropped the breeze, the sails dropped down. You see the thing, how the same thing he had brought over here and very beautifully, rhythmically he had put over the words. And all the words we know. So, it was sad as sad could be. Why? There is no wind. If there is no wind, our ship cannot go forward. And earlier there was no motorized ships. It all depends on the wind. Or else we have to make the, what we call as the oars, and it is a ship that cannot be done. And so they have to be there only hanging till the good atmosphere comes. And we did speak only to break the silence. We are speaking. There is no merriment. There is no enjoyment. There is no happiness. Then simply they are speaking to break the silence. Means they are afraid. If I don't speak, I may lose the capacity of speaking. And so they were speaking. To break the silence means that. They are afraid of the silence. And so they are speaking. All in a heart and copper sky, the bloody sun at noon, right up above the mast did stand, no bigger than the moon. We could see the red sun over there. The sky is red. The sky is red. And the sun is also red. Where he stood on this mast. But those rays do not contain required warmth in it. So, all in a hot and copper sky, whatever heat it has, with that the sky could able to become red enough to appear as if it is made of copper metal, right? The bloody sun at noon, the sun is also very red at noon. It should have been very bright at noon, but now he is just like a red ball, not more than the moon's size. This small, he is there on the head of the head, overhead, and it is on the mast. No bigger than the moon. Day after day, day after day, we struck nor breath, nor motion, as idle as a painted ship upon a painted ocean. Water, water everywhere, and all the birds did sing. Water, water everywhere, not any drop to drink. These are the famous lines. Water, water everywhere, and all the boats did sink. Water, water everywhere, nor any drop to drink. So now, day after day, we stuck, nor breathe, nor motion. We got stuck over there. We were there. Still, no motion, no movement, nothing. How does it appear? It appears as if there is a big canvas. On that, the ship has been painted. Painted ship, can it move? No, it cannot move. And our ship is also having same status as the painted ship. Day and day, day after day, every day, it is there only, no movement, no motion at all. So now we see water, water, everywhere water is there. Enough water, for what? For the ships to sink. If at all the ship is there, if underneath some iceberg comes and hit, it gets wrecked and we may sink down. That much of water is there. But can we enjoy that water? Can we drink the water? That water we cannot drink. Means what? We don't have food and we don't have water to drink even. Our condition has reached to that thing. Why? Because I killed that bird which was guiding us to get away from this situation. Unknowingly, unmindfully, I killed it. I committed a sin. And for that, I am being blamed by every navigator, even every mariner. He was nearly killing me with their words. See the thing. Now we got stuck over here. The ship is standing as if it is painted on a big paper. Right? So it is the situation now. Water, water everywhere. And all the boats did sink. Whatever ships are there, they all may sink down. Such amount of water is there. But water, water everywhere, nor any drop to drink. This is useless water to drink even. Means, inwardly it is said, they do not have water to drink. The very deep did rot, O Christ, that ever this should be. Yea, slimy things did crawl with legs upon the slimy sea. Now, what is the condition here? O God, O Christ, what is going to happen? This wood is there. The ship is made of wood. How long it can be there, stuck over there in one place? As long as it is sailing, the wood is not affected. If it is got stuck to some place, the wood gets start, what we can say, it may decay, starting decay. And many creatures may come in. Right? And there is no objection for them. They can move anywhere. Ship cannot go, but small creatures can move. Oh God, what is your creation here? That way, the poet is exclaiming for the power of God. Water everywhere, it can sink the ships, but there is no water for drinking. Oh God, a big ship got stuck here, it cannot move. But on the surface of the ice, we can see many creatures, they are moving. What a creation yours. It is really, we don't understand what it is. It is your creation. About in real and out, and real and out, the death fires danced at night. The water like a witch's oil burnt green and blue and white. During the night we see many colors on the water. Because there are creatures in the sea and they make the water appear like these many colors. And we just got afraid to even to look. Why? Is it some witch? Is it some she magician inside which is blaring up all these colors, flaring up all these colors inside? We don't know. We are completely afraid and we are sitting there about and about in real and rout. Real and rout, types of dance. We see the death fires danced at night. Death fire. Where is the fire then? Because there is fire, it is said, inside the ocean. Why? You must have seen this jugnu, what they call the firefly. And likewise, there are many fish inside the water which has a lighting effect on their body at their tail or nostrils or something. They will be emitting light. That is being seen. It is dancing on the ice. So they are completely became afraid of it. The water like witch's oils burnt green and blue and white. Sometimes it becomes blue, sometimes it becomes green, sometimes it becomes white. What is the color? We don't know. How they are coming, we don't know. But we are completely afraid of this fact over here. And some in dreams assured were of the spirit that plagued us so. 9 fathom deep he had followed us from the land of mist and snow. Hello, why do you bother? Because this is that demon. This is that spirit, that demon. Be assured, it has followed from there till here. And where does it dwell? 9 fathoms deep. Fathom is a measuring unit to measure the depth of the ocean. It is dwelling there. It followed us from there where we got stuck earlier. from where the albatross freed us. From there it followed us, and now here it stationed us, and it is emitting these lights, these colors, right? And some in dreams assured were of the spirit. Some we don't get sleep because of the surroundings, like these surroundings, we don't get sleep. But by chance, if somebody gets asleep, he will be talking in his sleep. What is that one? There must be some spirit in the ocean which has followed us so far, and it is making this fire. Any moment it can come up and it may eat us. That way they speak in the sleep itself, because they have seen, they are experiencing the nightmares over there. And every tongue through utter drought was withered at the root. We could not speak, no more than if we had been choked with the soot. Now, every tongue, every throat, it is completely parched, dried up. Why? There is no water to drink. And could we speak? We could. But what we spoke, we don't know. Why? Almost every throat is got choked up. There is no, what we can say, wetness inside to for the words to escape from it. Right? So here you see, and every tongue through utter drought means there is no water, even a single drop of water is not there. Water is there everywhere, no? No, water is there. Ships can sink, but there is no water to just wet our tongues. And so it has become drought over here, completely parched. If I put my finger here, no wetness at all. That way it got parched. Was withered at the root. Here, the tongue's root, if it is there here, from there it got completely dried up. Means quite below inside my stomach even, where suppose the juice is supposed to be there, there also nothing is there. It is completely dried up. We could not speak, no more than if we had been choked with soot. We could not speak. If at all we speak, what kinds of words are coming? As if my throat is choked with soot. What is this soot? Soot is that black powder which gets gathered when we put a lamp. The smoke, black smoke goes up, and wherever the ceiling is there, on the ceiling, it gathers, gets gathered. That is called soot. If you leave it for years together, then you can see the soot is dropping down. So my throat or our throats got patched to such an extent, words could not come. Even if words come, they are coming out of a certain thing which is completely filled with the soot. Likewise, the words are coming. What are those words? Nobody could able to say. Very difficult thing to get a word out of this throat. Why? It got patched, completely dried up. Words could not come. Hey, well a day, what evil looks had I from old and young. Instead of the cross, the albatross about my neck was hung. Hey, what are you looking at? I used to ask every person, why they look at me? They look at me as if I am a very strange creature here. Why? Everybody gets a cross hung in his neck. But I got an albatross hung in my neck. What is the symbolism over here? The cross is a place where Jesus Christ was nailed down. And every Christian wears it with reverence. Yeah. Right? And what am I carrying? Am I carrying the cross? as if a good Christian? No, I am carrying the sin of killing the albatross. Everybody was looking at me as if I am a great sinner. There the part 2 ends. Now, here are the questions. You have to read them very carefully. And when, because we understood the poem clearly, we could able to answer these things. And moreover, in your examination, these questions may not appear. An extract will be given, and before, ahead of the poem, ahead of the extract, or behind the extract, what occurred and what is there in that, likewise question may be asked. For that, you are to once again hear the poem explanation, you are to get a clarity over the poem, then you are getting ready for the examination.
If you like this video, please give a thumbs up. Please subscribe to our channel to get more videos on CBSE syllabus.